what a fun piece of music. Now, this isn't really Christmas music or anything, but a lot of my memories of this particular piece of music, which, by the way, is the Dukas Sorcerer's Apprentice, comes from me watching Fantasia, which is something that I watched often around this time of year when my kid was growing up. So there is an association for me with this piece, but you know what? It also happens to be on some auditions that are coming up, and I know many of you are taking them, and many of you are just interested in learning this piece. So here we're going to talk about the Sorcerer's Apprentice from Dukas. The bass clarinet part in this piece is pretty awesome. You have a lot of the melody, but it's also really hard, and as an added benefit slash pain in the ass, it is both in bass clef and treble clef, so it gives me an opportunity to talk about how to handle both clefs when you're looking at them in the same piece of music. Treble clef is different when you are playing it when it's associated with a bass clef part. We'll explain that in a minute. First, I'll play this excerpt for you. By the way, another plug for woodwindexcerpts.com. You guys are awesome. And they supply these PDFs so you can pick them up there. There's the link. Okay. Treble clef and bass clef. So here's how it works. Pretty simply put, if you see a piece of music with both treble and bass clef, especially if it's orchestral, this is how it works.
Hi, confusing side note here. Wagner and German notation parts do not always follow this convention. French notation parts almost always do. Dukas is French, so his music does.
Treble clef, as you read it, you need to play it up an octave from where it's written. You have to transpose it in here so that it sounds at the correct octave. Bass clef sounds at the octave with which it's written. Why the hell do I have to deal with this? Well, think about how a piano, a grand staff looks. Middle C, the C between the staves. Bass clef side of it looks here. This C is the same C as this one here. Those are the same notes. When you're reading treble clef on the bass clarinet itself is transposing itself down an octave from what's written. So think about it. You're reading the same note on a clarinet and fingering it the same way on a clarinet as you do on the bass clarinet. What's the problem here? Well, the bass clarinet is an octave lower than a clarinet. So therefore, as you're playing notes on the bass clarinet in treble clef as normally written, they sound down an octave. And because the clarinet itself sounds down a step, because it's a B-flat clarinet, which is a step lower than C, the bass clarinet, the B-flat bass clarinet, sounds down a step plus an octave. However, when you're reading bass clef, it doesn't. It just sounds down a step. So when you're reading stuff that is in the grand staff or in bass clarinet, you're looking at both treble and bass clef, everything is just down a step. The treble clef part is not considered transposing the rest of the way down the octave. Okay, this is sort of complicated, but everything you need to know is here. Too long, didn't listen, fine. Treble clef, when you are playing treble clef in a part that has both treble and bass, you have to transpose the treble clef part up an octave from where it's written. So if you see this C, you need to finger this C. On bass clef, if you see this C, you need to finger this C. So that's simply how it works, okay? So let's talk about this excerpt now. The first two notes in this excerpt, people almost always play too short. And in an orchestral audition situation, that's killer, play what's on the page exactly. So if you play, that's wrong. Why? Because those two notes are quarter notes, not eighth notes. So you need to play them their full length, which is two eighth notes worth. But make sure you put some daylight between them as that eighth rest shows. So that's what you have to know about this. And as you go down to rehearsal 24, notice that the slur goes all the way up to the D. If you look at the parts in woodwindexcerpts.com that are transposed for you, you will notice that just the grace notes are slurred. But in the actual part, the grace notes slur all the way into the eighth note. The difference is enough to get you disqualified. This is what it would sound like if you played just the treble clef part that's transposed for you. Shorten. That's wrong. is correct. You hear the difference? Play it slurred. That's the way it's written. Okay, on to the next excerpt. Okay, this excerpt, really simple, one thing to remember, and that is at the end of the decrescendo, that last note before you play that articulated E flat, that D, make it a little bit shorter. Put a legato with a little dot on it to remember that there needs to be a little bit of daylight, a little bit of space, a little bit of silence between that note and the E flat because you're making a decrescendo and otherwise it won't sound correct. Here it is correct. There's a little bit of pause in there. If you didn't, it would just sound connected. But with the pause in there, with the break, the little bit of silence, that E flat really comes out on its own. So that just goes to show you sometimes you need to prepare an articulated note with the note before it. In this case, that's definitely something you have to do. Okay, moving on. You're playing along with the brass. So freaking cool. Okay, this is a tough excerpt. Let me go ahead and play it for you. This, but it is freaking hard, and the hard part is the part basically right after rehearsal number 50. It's that grace note part. So let's talk about how to play the grace notes. Grace notes in general should not be the focus of the attention of the audience or you. You need to play them all, but they need not be accented, especially here. If you accent these notes, it makes the whole thing sound pedantic. It doesn't sound light, like it's a dance, which it should be. Here's what it sounds like if I were to play too much accent on those grace notes. Too much. I can't even do it. It just sounds so weird to me. The grace notes are almost like a ha. It's a pickup that if you articulate it too much with too much tongue, it's going to come out too strongly. Now, the way I do this is I don't actually tongue it. Instead, I use my air and I go ha da da ha da da ha da da instead of da 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 da. Here's how that sounds. Etc. Now here's the other issue with that part. There's nowhere to breathe. I can't play this whole passage without breathing. There's nowhere to circular breathe because I'm articulating and I can't circular breathe when I'm tonguing. So I actually leave a note out. And I don't know, in an audition situation that might count against me, but you know what would count worse against me is that if I ran out of breath and didn't finish it. So I take a breath in the middle and I take it in the second note of it so that I keep the ba 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 instead of going so I'm going ba 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 and it keeps the rhythm the same. I just skip that note. Here, I'll play it again. Thank you. making sure that you find a place, you always breathe there, you mark it in your part so that you remember to do it, will get you through this excerpt if you can't breathe all the way through it. And if you can, awesome. I just can't because I can't. Okay, so this was Sorcerer's Apprentice. Probably more of a Halloween piece, but so what? Any of you who are taking these auditions that are coming up, good luck to you. I hope you do great, and I hope this was helpful. See you next time. Bye.